to begin our third panel now. And as our moderator today, we have Frank Sesno. Frank is the director of the School of Media and Public Affairs at the George Washington University. He's an Emmy Award-winning journalist and the creator of planetforward.org, a user-driven web and television project that highlights innovations in sustainability. Frank's career includes 21 years at CNN, where he served as White House correspondent, anchor, and Washington bureau chief. And you can read more about Frank and the bios of all of our panelists in your program. Our panelists today are Marc Boutin, the Chief Executive Officer of the National Health Council; Dr. William Hait, Global Head of Janssen Research and Development and a Research America board member; Dr. Stephen Ostroff, the Acting Commissioner of the Food and Drug Administration; Amy Comstock Rick, President and CEO of the Food and Drug Law Institute and a Research America board member; and Dr. Larry Shapiro, the Executive Vice Chancellor for Medical Affairs and the Dean of the School of Medicine of Washington University in St. Louis, and another Research America board member. Welcome, everybody. Frank.
Thank you, Mary. It's great to be here and great to be with Research America. Always enjoy our work together. I'm looking forward to this conversation very much because this is sort of one of the hot buttons of the 21st century, right? How quickly can we make technology, data, science, and approvals work to suit our attention spans? Back in July, I periodically sit in for Diane Rehm on National Public Radio, and we did a program on this very topic and on the 21st Century Cures Act. And as you can imagine, the phone calls from the audience were animated, because people feel very strongly about this, that either their health is being utterly compromised by big pharma, or that it's being held up by big government. And finding that happy space in between isn't easy. So let me start by asking you, and Larry, I'll start with you, at a time when science is moving faster than ever, when data is bigger than ever, when social media are more social than ever, do we have a 21st century FDA or a 20th century FDA? What are the priorities? You'll notice where I started, by the way. I did get approval for this before. I got FDA approval before we came.
Well, I would say that, first off, the FDA is in many ways one of the most poorly understood public agencies and maligned. And I think we can't overlook the role that they have played in keeping us safe. If you look back over the last many years at new device and new drug introductions, the number of adverse events and outcomes have really been relatively minimal. So I think as we discuss what we need to do going forward, we shouldn't neglect acknowledging what has taken place.
What are the priorities as far as you're concerned going forward?
Well, I think modernizing the way clinical trials are undertaken so that we have smart clinical trials that make use of genomic and other information and stratifying patients, selecting patients, so that we can have surrogate endpoints that are meaningful and we can reach decisions faster. I think there is a lot in regulatory science now that would allow us to move forward, but it's a partnership issue. It's not just the FDA that has to be responsive. I think industry, academia, and so forth need to be responsive as well.
I mean, what's your answer to that?
I want to start by picking up on your FDA approval. I think regulatory science right now is often viewed in the context of the pivotal moment is approval, and that's where FDA's power is coming from. But to look at it from the perspective of the outside pressures FDA is under right now, more and more we're looking at approvals going through expedited review, which one could say may therefore be based on less data. And I come at this from a legal perspective. We're also in a place right now where there's some recent court decisions that are allowing, seemingly going, they're still early, but going in the direction where industry can actually share communications, if it's truthful, about research it's done for on-off-label use. So we're in a situation right now where if that continues, that trend continues, industry may be able to communicate about off-label use. Does that diminish the value of FDA approval, in fact? Because if you can get a drug approved on a very narrow indication, but then communicate more on areas of potential off-label use, if it's truthful, and this is all very early, does that make FDA approval the moment that we're looking at? Or are we actually looking at a place where the FDA needs to shift to an agency, it's a legal issue, Congress would have to be involved, where safety and efficacy for real-world use is very much a part of the regulatory science conversation? And just to add one more piece to that, with big data and all these data sets we're looking at, patients and clinicians are looking for real-world data on how drugs are actually being used, not just what they're approved for. So should the role of the FDA be shifting to much more of a continuum in the public health conversation?
I'm virtually positive that everybody in the room understands what you're talking about with real-world data, but just to be sure, would you define that?
Sure, and actually we may have many definitions in the room, but what I'm talking about
is... Since our real worlds all differ.
Right, exactly. What I'm talking about is where we can look, where a clinician can access data, if we ever can get these data sets to be able to talk to each other, to find out what the actual experience of taking a particular therapy is with comorbidities and more than one drug, that kind of thing, of who actually succeeds, who has unfortunate events, that kind of thing.
Steven, since you're acting commissioner, I'll give you the option of going next or going last.
You know, the alternative is to wait until I hear what everybody else has to say. But, I think your question is really a good one. And I'll answer that by saying that I tend to be a data-driven person. For those who don't know, before I stepped into the acting commissioner's role, I was in the role of the chief scientist for the agency. So I like data. And what I would say is that, you know, today's FDA is a considerably different organization than it was in 2000 or even back in the 1990s. And I think most of the industry knows that. And if you look at the more recent track record of the agency, the number of new drug approvals that we had in 2014 was, you know, sort of at a record level, not only in terms of the absolute numbers, I think the number that we use is 51 between the drugs and the biologics, but also the speed of those approvals is considerably faster than it was previously. And so I think the numbers speak for themselves. You know, there was a article, I think, recently in Forbes that indicated that, you know, when you look at the more recent data, our approval rate on applications that come into the agency is somewhere in the range of, I think they quoted 89%. That's their data, not my data. And they were raising the question, have we gone too far in one direction? I think that there are a lot of reasons that the number is as high as it is, and it's because of some of the pathways that Amy was talking about, where we have a lot of dialogue, we have a lot of discussion about the design of not only the studies, but also the design of the application before it even gets into the agency, which I think accounts for some of the increased speed, as well as the effectiveness of the approval process. And so I do think that we have a pretty good story to tell here. We use a lot of adaptive designs, and industry uses now a lot of adaptive designs that come into the agency, and play a very critical role in terms of getting to yes. And so I do think that the agency has definitely adapted, and I mean, my answer to you is yes,
presumably,
we're doing better.
Presumably, well, that's right.
And
presumably, you wouldn't
process.
Say the job is done.
No, the job will never be done because, you know, we live in an era where the pace of innovation is really astronomical.
So what are the priorities as far as you're concerned for the FDA of the future and moving forward?
Well, I think that we, you know, one of the things that's critical, and again, looking at my role from the regulatory science perspective, is that it's really important for us to keep up with the pace of change, the pace of innovation, and make sure that we have the skill sets that we need to be able to properly evaluate what comes before the agency. That is not an easy task.
We'll come back and dive into that some more, but I want to let Marc jump in here. Marc.
So I represent 133 million people with chronic disease and disabilities. Most of those people have more than one chronic condition. If you think about this question from their perspective, the answer is absolutely no. There's no question about it. For somebody living and dying with one or more chronic conditions, we cannot do this fast enough. I also want to be very clear that we've worked very closely with the FDA over the last 10, 12 years, and we've seen tremendous improvement. We've seen tremendous work accomplished there. I think there's still a lot of opportunity to move forward, but from a patient perspective, we're not there yet. We may not get there for quite some time, but we're in an environment where we've built a system that is constrained by all the stakeholders. And this is an area of intense gray. We keep thinking of it as black and white. Are we getting to the approval stage fast enough? Are we getting products into the hands of people who are dying as a result of their condition, willing to take substantial risk? And are we getting products into the hands of people that may be misused and caused harm? It is not black and white, it's intensely gray. And the answer is not the same for every product that goes through the FDA. So we have to look at how we become much more nuanced, how we include technology at the front end and back end at FDA in very different, very innovative ways. But I'm pleased to say in our work with the FDA, we've seen a great deal of movement over the last few years.
So you have the opportunity, you're sitting next to the acting commissioner now. So feel free to go ahead and suggest to him two or three things that would make this happen.
I am always open to suggestions.
So, so I have a fantastic board member who said to me that everybody's going to walk up to you as the CEO of the organization, and they're going to say, I don't want to tell you how to do your job, but everything before but was irrelevant. And not to listen to what he says after but. Let me say this. From a patient perspective, we've looked at the FDA, and everybody talks about what is called the gold standard. And that is the clinical trial process, gold standard. Well, you know what? When we say something is the best, it makes it really hard to innovate. And there's actually really good research on that. When you determine something is the best, well, you don't want to change it because you're already the best. Well, in this day and age, with the way technology has evolved, the way information has evolved, the way healthcare systems are evolving, we need to be able to include information at the front end that's very different. And I'm pleased to say that FDA has been very responsive in patient-focused drug development. There's a huge opportunity to ensure that the patient perspective is included in drug development at the front end, and we have the opportunity to answer questions that are important to patients. You know, with the 20 meetings that FDA has been conducting, at every single meeting, folks from the FDA have walked away where they thought they understood what was important to the patient, and that information had been given to them through surrogates, doctors, researchers, others. And in every instance, they were wrong. And that has created this cultural aha moment that we have to figure out how to get that information at the front end and use that to develop programs to make much higher value products, to make decisions about benefit risk.
So are you saying not the gold standard, another standard?
I'm saying let's not say it's the best. Let's keep evolving and improving this.
Bill, I'll come to you in a minute, but I do want to hear, Steve, your response to that.
Well, I think Marc is absolutely right. And we have been listening quite intently to patients. And in both the PDUFA, and I hate to use sort of the acronyms, but the user fee for prescription drugs for PDUFA 5, patient-focused drug development was a very important component, and that's where those 20 listening sessions arose from. And I can assure you that it is also going to be critical to the discussions that are ongoing with number 6, which we're currently in the process of now. Marc was at our original meeting, and so we want to be able to continuously change and adapt to environments where we can receive information from all of the various stakeholders in order to be able to come to the appropriate decisions. And we're certainly also very appreciative of the fact that the benefit-risk ratio is not a static figure. In fact, you know, one of the challenges is that right now it's very largely a qualitative concept in terms of trying to balance benefit versus risk, but we recognize that it can be a very sliding scale depending on the seriousness of the disease itself that you're approaching, and that patients are very often willing to take additional risk in order to have things that may be life-saving to them or that may be extremely beneficial to them. And we are working quite hard in terms of being able to conduct a lot of the formulative work to be able to make that more quantitative in terms of how we assess and how we utilize patient input into the decisions.
You said earlier, though, that you're a data guy.
Yes, I am a data guy.
Because you're the chief. Well, right. So is this changing the way you consider data or the type of data that you're going to use because it's coming from?
Oh, absolutely. No, I don't think there's any question about that.
Bill, let me come down. I'm sorry that you've been able to take all this in, and you can have the ultimate overview word here.
Right. So, and of course, I have the perspective of the pharmaceutical industry of interacting with the FDA on a regular basis with our products and also as a member of Steve's FDA Science Board. And following up on what Steve said, what's absolutely critical to keep in front of our minds is the responsibility of getting the balance between safety and efficacy right. And what we need to do as a community is to provide the FDA with the data and the tools, no matter what format or what form that may take as that evolves with time, so they can make these very, very, sometimes very, very difficult decisions. Sometimes when a drug is incredibly active and incredibly safe, no-brainer. When a drug is not so active and has all sorts of toxicities, no-brainer. Many of them fall in the gray zone, and it takes enormous judgment. And my experience now working with inside the FDA, both in both roles, particularly with the FDA Science Board and getting to know the people, these are remarkably dedicated people who take their responsibility, the public responsibility, the public good as public service, incredibly seriously. We should be very proud of these people because I'm telling you, they're working hard and they're not making a fortune doing it. Believe me.
We're in a town and where Congress gets to weigh in on these things periodically, known for innovation and expediency. they've been working on something called the Faster Cures Act. By the time they get to it, it might have been the Slower Passage Act. But I want to ask you all about that and specifically what's at stake here. There was an interesting piece written, co-written in the New York Times not long ago, back in June. You may have seen it. David Kessler put his name to this, and he wrote the following. In the wake of the innovations of the early AIDS era, new drug approvals by the FDA have become the fastest in the world. The agency has introduced new mechanisms such as fast track and breakthrough drug designations that are increasingly being used to speed life-saving new treatments to market. But, he writes, the 21st Century Cures Act could substantially lower the standards for approval of many medical products, potentially placing patients at unnecessary risk of injury or death. While the legislation does not mandate this approach, it opens the door to it. Does it?
You know, the original versions of this bill had a number of parts of it that made us somewhat uncomfortable. We were able, and I think that there was a great deal of opportunity for technical assistance and input as this bill went along on the House side, where at the end of the day, I think that we were very comfortable with the content of that bill, and I will continue to say that we are comfortable with the content of that bill, that it does not do things that would significantly cause concerns for us, for our ability to do our job effectively, which is to be able to evaluate products for their effectiveness and for their safety. Having said that, you know, our concern continues to be the costs that are associated with doing the things that we are being asked to do in that bill. I've had this conversation with Mary and others over the last few months that we were certainly happy with the fact that there were funds dedicated for FDA. Our estimation, and I think the estimation of the CBO, is that the funds that are available are not going to necessarily cover everything that we are being expected to do in that bill. And so then the question is, if we end up having to do that, and of course we don't know what's going to come out on the Senate side and what will ultimately come out in the final version of this, then, you know, those resources have to come from somewhere. And as I pointed out earlier, there are a number of things that I think that we can point to that we're doing extremely well. And we don't want to do anything to jeopardize the successes that we've had. And so our focus right now isn't so much on what the content is, but whether or not we are going to be able to accomplish everything that we're being asked to do in that bill.
Let me ask Larry some of the content. Some of the things that Kessler raises, for example, he said the current version of the bill would allow consideration of drug approvals based on clinical experience. He's concerned that provisions that could mandate use of biomarkers to approve a wider variety of drugs. You concerned about the speed versus safety equation here?
Well, I think we have to be concerned about it, but speed is really something when we're dealing with chronic diseases, when we're dealing with the expectations of the public and so forth, and we just have to take advantage of all the technology that we have available to us. If you're trying to develop a new therapeutic for Alzheimer's disease, you know, waiting 5 to 10 years to see whether there's efficacy associated with a new drug just doesn't cut it. And so we have to make use of biomarkers and other tools to really design trials that will get us there faster. Speed is important. Lives are at stake. Several people have said that. So I think it is a balance, but there are things that we can do to make things go faster.
Faster cures? Where are you in this?
For 21st century cures, there's certainly a lot in there. I understand exactly what Steve was saying, that it's a resources question, but I would, as I did before, broaden the question a little bit. Resources is not just an issue for what would be statutorily mandated, but with the emphasis, there's some of it in 21st century cures, but with some of the expedited review, the emphasis we have on post-market data gathering, I don't know that we have enough resources every time there's a signal or a concern coming out of post-market data, if we have the resources to do the follow-up research that's needed. And if we don't have enough resources, what do? You have to prioritize in terms of what you'll look at and what you won't. Will you just withdraw a drug or will you actually do follow-up research? How are we going to make those decisions about what we do follow up on, what we devote resources to, and what we don't? And I don't know that that legislation has addressed that question. I don't really think it has. And I don't really know as a society if we know how we want to follow up on that, prioritizing in a time of limited resources.
Well, let me just make one, again, getting back to data, because we've sort of looked at some data, and if you look at, you know, it seems like ancient history already, but if you look at the period 2010 to 2012, there were a total of 94 drug approvals during that period. And when you actually look at the information that went into those approvals, almost half of them used surrogate endpoints. And in many, if not most of those instances, those surrogate endpoints used biomarkers. And so this isn't something new and different for us. The challenge is that the evidence of the clinical validity of the biomarker needs to be relatively solid and needs to be demonstrated, and part of the challenge, and I know from the standpoint of an organization like Research America, a big part of the challenge is to be able to do a lot of the basic research that needs to be done to be able to say what are effective biomarkers for things like Alzheimer's and for many diseases. We just know the information isn't there yet to be able to say that this is an adequate biomarker for that particular disease. And that's one of the big challenges. And so, you know, that has to be as much of a focus of this issue of being able to qualify the biomarkers once this has been established.
I wanted to paraphrase Albert Einstein in this particular issue. He said something like, we should do it as fast as possible, no faster. and I think the reason why that's such an important thing to keep in mind, because when you do an experiment, whether it's a new drug, new device, whatever, there's actually three possible outcomes. It could be better, it could be no better, or it could be a hell of a lot worse. And although we think we know when we're going in, especially to these very early trials where phase one extensions can lead to an approval, we think we know until we actually have the data. And all three possibilities are very real. So I think some caution is always going to be necessary.
I want to go ahead.
I was just to ask if I could ask Steve a question.
Oh, please.
Do you think with the provisions in 21st Century Cures that put a strong emphasis on biomarkers that it will actually change FDA behavior if it's approved?
Well, again, you know, from our perspective, we, you know, look at things through the lens of effectiveness, and we look at things through the lens of safety. And I don't think that we want to veer away from that, because it has served us incredibly well for a very long period of time. And so to the extent that biomarkers can assist in rendering the appropriate decision regarding the efficacy and the safety of a product, they will be valuable.
We're going to, in a few minutes, come to audience questions. Before we do that, I want to touch on a couple of things. But before we move away from the Hill, right, now it's the Senate's turn. Mm-hmm. You were saying before that you think that's going to start next month sometime.
Well, it's started now. I mean, but it's been going on now for a number of months. Right. But, you know, we're likely to see a version of their output sometime next month, at least. That's
what are your greatest, what information to all of you, anyone who wishes to jump in as this conversation moves forward up on the Hill, that's going to affect your life and all of our lives as a result. What are the two or three things that you're most concerned about that you're hearing and that you think and feel most strongly need to be got right in this process? They're all listening to you now.
Well, sure they are, just like they always do.
That's another panel.
I should say that we shouldn't overlook some of the really important things that probably everybody in this room agrees upon. More funding for the NIH. It's really critical that we keep the stream of basic research going. Also, more focus on groups that are not currently well represented in clinical trials, minorities, women, children, et cetera. And then decreasing some of the regulatory burden that occurs for scientists as well as on the FDA side. And there are provisions in the bill, the House version of the bill, that deal with those things. I would hope they would stay there.
Marc?
So two things I want to put on the table. One is, to your earlier question, patient preference data is one of the items that's been called into controversy, saying somehow that would lower the standard. It's not lowering the standard, it's adding more information. And that is critical, because right now, when treatments come out, they're approved for being safe and efficacious. But it doesn't describe it in the context of the burden of disease or the burden of treatments that may exist. And that information, if it makes it into the label and gets into the healthcare system where you can have a conversation with a provider, allows you to make an informed decision about the trade-offs that meet not only your clinical outcome needs, but your social, economic, personal needs and the goals that you have. We don't have that ability now. And there are multiple treatments that exist in certain conditions, some of which have trade-offs. It's very hard to get that information to the patient. That is something that is critical, and that helps with compliance, adherence, improves health outcomes, huge opportunities moving forward. So that's number one. That needs to stay in there. It's in the House version. I think we're going to see an improved version in the Senate. The second thing that was something that was dropped from the House version, and that was a set of incentives to develop treatments for unmet medical needs. We have not had the conversation as a society about how we incentivize treatments. The patent system works sometimes, but it creates perverse disincentives in many other instances. Dormant Therapies Act, which has been introduced in both houses of Congress, was meant to be part of 21st century cures again got dropped. We're hopeful it'll be part of the Senate. And I'll just give you one example. If you're looking at Alzheimer's, that's a condition. If you want to show that you can change the progression of that disease, you need to do a 15-year clinical trial. And that runs concurrently with your 20 years of patent life. We ironically incentivize the development of treatments for conditions that you don't have to show that level of therapies.
But to this point, this is why in the bill it's so important to the focus on surrogate endpoints. Because this whole issue, to me, and it's called 21st century cures, but in the bill it's also referring to prevention. But without surrogate endpoints, to say we can be reasonably sure that if you lower your LDL cholesterol, you're going to have good cardiovascular outcomes, and other things, perhaps an amyloid phospho-tau, or, sorry, an Alzheimer's phospho-tau or beta amyloid, these things have to have some degree of assurance that these surrogate endpoints are going to be meaningful, so you don't have to wait 15 years to see a drug developed. That's very, very important, and encouraging research in that area could be tremendously helpful.
Amy, did you want to jump in?
Well, I couldn't agree more about the need for surrogate endpoints, diseases like Alzheimer's and Parkinson's, where it moves forward. But I also personally would be, I'm really excited about the aspects that would focus on the FDA using, as a phrase I used earlier, more real-world data in its decision-making, how drugs are actually used by people and how they're prescribed by clinicians. I think that's really important. I understand the value of the and the importance of the scientific rigor in a gold standard clinical trial, but that isn't how the patients in this real world are taking drugs. And I think it would be the extent we can push the FDA to perhaps simultaneously, I don't know if what I'm saying is possible, but to be able to focus on real world use and rigorous science in making its decisions, I think that'd be a step forward.
Well, let me just make a couple of points. First of all, it's, you know, it's, I think the only federal employee up here on the panel. It's difficult for me to talk about pending legislation itself, but what I will say is that there is one provision in the House bill that was passed, which for us, and I think for many that are from industry that are out in the audience, they know is very critical for us, and that is the hiring provisions. Absolutely. That were contained in 21st Century Cures, particularly as it relates to direct hiring authority, which is a little bit of a sort of an esoteric issue, but particularly the salaries, because we know that in certain very critical areas where we need really highly skilled individuals to be able to appropriately evaluate some of the things that are coming into us, we need really, really good people, and it has been a major challenge for us to be able to accomplish that. I think the other provision, which for us is a very beneficial provision, and again, it's a sort of the esoterica of federal government, has to do with sequestration as it relates to user fees. Another thing that's really, really important to us, because we know that some of the reasons that we did not meet our goals in the last user fee program is because of the results of sequestration. So these will make a big difference to us, and certainly anything that's going on in the Senate side, we would like to see that preserved.
What more do you have to say about the real-world data?
Well, real-world data is a very interesting question, and it is something that we increasingly are looking at, but I think that you have to sort of separate the use of real-world data after approval from the use of real-world data for evaluating effectiveness of a particular therapy. We have been doing a lot of work trying to see how we can take better advantage of what's going on these days with big data to be able to use it in the pre-market circumstances.
What are you doing differently as a result?
So, one of the major things that we're doing with real-world data these days is in the post-market setting is something called the Sentinel Initiative. And, that uses amazingly large amounts of data to be able to look for signals of both safety signals, but as well as whether or not to confirm some of the information that became available to us in the clinical trial setting. And so it's been a remarkable game changer for us. I can also say in the pre-market circumstances, one of the areas that we see really significant benefit from real-world data is when you have a circumstance where a drug has already been approved. And give an example. A drug that's been approved for use in lung cancer, and we know that in real world settings it is being used to treat some other type of cancer, liver cancer or something like that. There may be a lot of available information to suggest to us that it actually is quite effective in these other circumstances, and that data can be then used to be able to change the labeling for these other indications. I think that's a great example of how we can use that type of data.
Bill, let me turn the heat up on you for just a second, because so much of the focus here has been on the FDA and how can the FDA move quicker. But there are plenty of people who say that the pharmaceutical industry is all about getting everybody to move quicker so it can make more money and it can bring its products to market, and that the public's interests could be compromised in that process. How hard are you pushing, and what do you say to that?
So I'll share with you a very interesting experience that we've had recently with the FDA with the new breakthrough therapy designations. And we were very fortunate to have some of the earliest breakthrough therapy indications for drugs we were developing. So we didn't completely understand what it meant, so we went down and we met with the FDA, members of the FDA, and we said to them, really, you're going to help us move the process along? And you think we should start filing? We don't think we can manufacture that. We don't think we can have the drug ready by the timelines you're giving us. And with a big smile on their face, they said, what do you mean you can't keep up with the FDA? So, I think the pharmaceutical industry is developing drugs to and being held to a very high standard in terms of data. When in academics, we used to say the data has to be publication grade. For drug development in the industry, it has to be industrial grade, because we're held to a standard much higher than almost any journal, which is the FDA, because the reviews are very rigorous. So I believe we're moving at a reasonable pace. And we're always trying to do what we believe would be best for the patients.
Larry, would you weigh in on this as the dean of the School of Medicine here, and thinking also about real-world data, observational data, all the different kinds of data information we're talking about?
Well, I think one of the real challenges we're all struggling with is the rate at which new information is coming online and affecting what and how we might do it. The issue of cancer therapy was mentioned a minute ago and so forth. I think the data that's come from genomic studies has indicated that cancers are much better classified by the nature of the mutations that they harbor than the tissue in which they originate. And yet, the trials that we do and the patient recruitment has not caught up with that just as yet. We have the opportunity to use other new information in developing adaptive trials that the FDA has started to move on. But one can now monitor the course of treatment of a cancer patient where there are individual clones of that patient's cancer, and some are responding to the therapy and other clones are not. And if you don't know that in real time, you can't really develop a trial that will show what drugs are effective and what are efficacious. So I see the big challenge is, how do we keep industry, academia, the FDA all moving at a pace that keeps up with the pace of the science?
Are we on the right track? Do we have the model for that? Or does there need to be something even more fundamental discussed here on how these different elements, aspects of science and data are coming together and being coordinated?
Well, I think we need to be sitting in the same room more often. There's a lot of communication that takes place back and forth in the case of industry and the FDA is very formalized oftentimes and follows certain proscribed patterns. I think there's a need to have more open and candid conversation so that people can understand the problems that we're all struggling with. And, forums like this help. But I think there need to be other opportunities to do that, too.
The FDA is saddled, I think, with another problem. Depends on how you look at it. But because of the problem of perceived conflicts of interest, the advisors that they're allowed to use often aren't the ones who are most familiar with the topic. And it can get to an extreme where you have a panel who are advising the FDA, and of course they're only advisors, but that I think creates problems that I think would be nice to, we may have gone too far, the pendulum might have swung too far in this real conflicts of interest versus perceived conflict of interest, because that doesn't help the FDA to not have experts having those discussions with them.
Steve, is that a big problem?
Well, I'd like to get to a point that was just raised, which is I totally agree with you that the more dialogue and the more stakeholders that you can have talking to each other, the better off I think everybody will be, and that includes patients.
Exactly.
I just think that that's critical, and you know, one of the things that we are actively promoting, and I will say, and Bill knows this very well, we changed a lot as a result of some input that we received from our science board a number of years ago, and we've made significant changes, particularly as it relates to the area of public-private partnerships. And we are much more external as an organization than we used to be. And I think one of the examples of that is that we've created something called Centers of Excellence in Regulatory Science. We now have four of these, including one that's a consortium between UCSF and Stanford. It's a great way for us to be able to collaborate with academia to do some of the things that we need to do to generate the science that will help us make appropriate decisions. And I think that you will see, because we have another a follow-up report coming from our science board that's supposed to be coming out within the next week or two, that I think will amplify better use of some of these opportunities. And so I think that we as an organization are always very open to seeing ways that we can partner with a variety of stakeholders, including regulated industry, to be able to do things better.
Point on this, because I think, and I'm glad you said patients need to be part of this.
Yeah. Mark, while Mark's thinking, when he's done, we'll come to the mics, and we'll come to your question. So go ahead.
Thank you. Patients have often been excluded, and when you bring patients into the mix and allow them to participate in the conversation almost always goes in a different direction. And it almost always ends up in a better place. Adaptive clinical trials is a great example. If we're part of that conversation, the clinical trials are going to shift, because quite frankly, if they don't, you're creating situations where patients are in clinical trials that may or may not work that we could have determined. That's unethical. That makes no sense. And with patient participation, we give you the ability to say, no, wait, this is wrong. We need to do it differently. I'll use J&J as an example with what they've done with the access on compassionate use. They've brought in patients. They've looked at this from the perspective of what is important. How do we create a system that is fair, it's equitable, everybody gets a shot, and the patient has been part of developing that in a very open, transparent way. That's how we need to look at these issues. We'll give you a very, very different perspective and a better outcome.
Okay, let's come to a question on the floor, and the microphone is in the back, so who's going to start?
Thanks. Lucinda Main from AACP. I'd like all the panelists to reflect on where we are vulnerable in our scientific workforce for the kind of innovation and regulatory science that's coming down the pike.
Well, I'll start off, since we're supposed to be responsible for helping to create that workforce. Stable, predictable research funding is critical to get people to go into the kinds of careers that we're talking about here. A day doesn't go by that somebody doesn't come into my office and tell me not only of their great disappointment of not being able to carry out their work and so forth, and the fact that they've had to resubmit the same proposal six times in order to get funded, they're leaving the career. They're leaving the field because of their frustration. So I don't think we'll have the kind of workforce that we need if we don't have a predictable future that people can see as a career path for themselves in this area.
I would second that. I sit on the NIH Neurological Institute Council, and it's a regular topic of conversation how the young investigators are leaving their emotional state, their depression at the field they've chosen is a common topic, and I think that is certainly a significant issue, and it pushes a lot of the emphasis at NIH to make sure that the funding for basic research remains as strong as it can be in this era of tight resources, so those grants will come through. But then I feel a tension there between some of the translational and clinical research questions that no single industry player has the incentive to follow up on. And so I personally might look to the government for that, but then we also look to the government to maintain the basic research workforce, and I just don't think we've hit that right balance yet because we aren't giving enough money to it.
It's a great, I'm wondering how much has this changed and over what period of time?
I'm going to ask Steve. I don't know.
Is this just always part of the challenge and the background noise,
because of the tightening of resources?
It's gone down. Sorry, yeah.
Yeah, I mean we've lost 28% of the purchasing power of the NIH dollar in the last decade, and the pay lines, the success rate of people applying for grants has just fallen through the floor. And it's incredibly discouraging. And I've been in this business a long time, and there always have been ups and downs, but nothing like the cycle that we're currently in.
Well, I'm going to answer that question a little bit differently because I look at it from, FDA as an organization. And one of the things that I think is that many scientists that are out there don't look at FDA as a scientific organization. They look at NIH as doing science. We have about 16,000 employees at NIH, and 10,000 of them are in scientific categories. And so, recognizing, number one, that we do science, and number two, that there are career opportunities at an agency like FDA that can be very interesting career opportunities, I think is, a message I can't say often enough. There are certain categories that we have tremendous difficulty recruiting. One of them is in the statistical category. Another one is informatics, and part of the informatics is because they're in such great demand these days because of everything going on around precision medicine, et cetera. And so those are particular needs of ours. But it's such a broad question, but I think fundamentally we need to sort of get the word out that we really need good scientists. And the last thing that I'll say is that we need people who can integrate information from a variety of scientific disciplines. This is no longer a circumstance where you can be really, really good in one area, because for an agency like FDA, we need people who understand some of the basic science around, genomics and genetics and whole genome sequencing, to people who understand behavioral science. And for us as an agency to do our job right, we have to be able to integrate all of that.
Bill, how about
often in the same person.
How about the question from the perspective of the private sector?
Yeah, what I was going to say, what was very much what Steve was talking about, the ability of scientists to handle very complex data sets that are coming off of deep sequencing, that are coming off transcriptional profiling, that are coming off very complex proteomic methodologies, that are only getting, these data sets are only getting more complicated, and the tools to analyze those data sets can be very tricky. And you can apply one tool to a data set and get one answer, you can apply another statistical tool and get a completely different answer. And you really need very deep expertise, because this is coming forward as part of companion diagnostic testing. So if you want to develop your drug with a companion diagnostic test and you think you've got it, the analysis right, it's very important that the regulators also have the scientific expertise to say yes or no, you've got it right. So I think this is going to be an even bigger issue as we move forward with companion diagnostic test in precision medicine.
Question over here.
Hello. Hi, my name is Yanru Leibovitz. I'm a PhD student in the Translational Biology, Medicine, and Health program at Virginia Tech. And I can echo that sometimes my career outlook feels bleak sometimes. Sometimes it's sunny.
Keep heart.
But I wonder, what does a private public partnership look like at the local level, particularly if we're not part of a center of excellence yet, but we have passion for the regs and we're interested in regulatory science, what can we do?
So if that's directed towards me, we have I think it's a very good question, because one of the things that I think that we need to do is we need to grow programs that recognize regulatory science as a legitimate scientific discipline, and increasingly we do see a variety of academic settings that are really taking on regulatory science, developing programs in regulatory science, and finding sources of funding to be able to do work related to regulatory science. I think that that is really quite vital. You know, FDA is not primarily a funding agency, and so we're not an agency that puts a large amount of resources out there. So we're going to have to do this in partnership with stakeholders who really see the benefit of having good science that can help in decision making once you have the basic science accomplished, once you have done the work to translate that basic science into usable products, that there is a lot of science that's necessary to bring those products across the finish line. And so, you know, we do have some mechanisms to be able to provide resources, not only through our centers of excellence, but also through something that we call the broad agency announcement, where we do put out funding for opportunities that come before the agency, but we're not going to be able to do this
ourselves. See, what I was thinking was the Commissioner's Fellowship Program.
Yes,
that is absolutely fantastic. We just reviewed it. The science work.
And I just spoke at our graduating class yesterday. So
absolutely fantastic opportunity for people who want to get into this and learn how it, you know, really get under the hood and learn how this works. Phenomenal program.
You're getting this? Are you inspired now? Okay, good. Yes, sir.
Hi, Larry Hausner, board member at Research America. I want to get to a point, back to a point that Bill made before that I don't think got answered, which was about the scientific, that the scientists who are on the panels with the conflict of interest parameters that you currently have, are you satisfied with who is there? Is this causing a problem? Is this something that we need to look at to make changes in the future?
Yeah. I don't know, Bill. Do you want to go first?
Well, I have to be very careful because it could get back to these panels and we'd be screwed. But
nobody will tweet. Pay no attention to the camera.
But I think the principle is the greater the expertise, subject matter expertise on the panels, the more rigorous and the better the reviews. And let me leave it at that, because
I have to be very careful in this area because, you know, we as a regulatory agency, given how much we regulate, need to be very careful that we that there isn't a perception that the process wasn't as rigorous and free of conflict of interest as possible. Having said that, we are very much aware of this particular problem and are looking at various ways that we could make sure that we can get the expertise that we need to be able to make.
Well, I was going to ask you, how can you get the expertise?
Well, you know, again, we're sort of looking at everything, including, you know, potentially trying to lower some of the burdens that we place on our outside experts in terms of financial disclosure forms and those sorts of things. Even when we have people that are inactive, we require certain things that people find so burdensome that they, you know, we've had people that have resigned simply because they don't want to keep up with all the paperwork. So there are ways that we can potentially, I think, simplify the process that would be very beneficial. But I do think that we need to explore ways that we can make sure that we can access the expertise that we need to be able to make the most appropriate decisions without potentially jeopardizing or calling into question any of the decisions that we eventually make.
One of the reasons
it's a tough balancing act.
One of the reasons the patient community took on patient engagement in the context of benefit risk and drug development was after PDUFA 4, we saw the conflict of interest debate shift. And it shifted to a point that patients were finding that they were often conflicted out of advisory committees. It was a huge challenge to participate. And we thought, well, this is crazy. We're a non-voting member on an advisory board, and we can't even get on because of conflicts. So we started to work with the FDA to develop this schematic where we could get very sophisticated engagement data that could inform decision making that would be outside of the conflict of interest process. So I think there are ways to get at this, but we have to be careful, because I agree with you. The pendulum has swung too far to one end.
Yeah. Can I just follow up? Actually, this is not on the ethics point, but the patient engagement effort, too, tends to come in much earlier in the process. The advisory committees tend to be much later and don't always occur. So I think that's of a benefit that is far beyond just a voice in the advisory committee.
Right. The very first time I got behind the wheel of a car in the United Kingdom, sitting on the wrong side of the car, driving on the wrong side of the road, I drove into a roundabout in the wrong direction. And it's a very good thing I made it out. This, it seems to me, is the roundabout of science and medicine. A great amount of data, very politicized process, gigantic public opinion and public pressure, the private sector and the public sector all coming together, and all of these forces are swirling around and figuring out how you get to the other side when everybody's driving faster and faster all the time is immensely challenging. But it's also one of the interesting things in why you must have a career in regulatory science because it's not going anywhere. I want to thank the panel very much and thank you for your questions. And Mary, back to you.
Well, thank you. I really like that roundabout analogy. Oh, please, you don't have to stand up there, but we thank you. The roundabout analogy really is a good one, and it goes to the sitting down together and trying to solve problems, and all the while assuring that those folks that we know are up there in the Capitol are part of the solution. And get engaged, and they're not going to get engaged unless we engage them, including on the campaign trail, which is another pitch for joining us on the campaign for the cures. But we also want you to stay joined to Research America, to keep engaging us. Let us know what further questions and comments you had as a result of being part of this conversation today. Be in touch with us to let us know what your solutions are and new ways that we might be thinking usefully to become the kind of effective advocates that we constantly aspire to. I really take the point about when you define yourself as the best, it makes it harder to get better. And I think that's true for all of us who are involved in the work that we do in different ways to assure medical progress. We know we're doing as well as we can, but we also know that we can do better. And it's working together, I think, that is the key to that. So thank you for being here today. Thank you for being part of Research America. And a special thanks to our sponsors, our lead sponsor, Astellas, and all of you who have made this first-rate program possible. Thanks, and have a great afternoon.